Hi students, welcome back to geology. Now we are going to start looking at the physical properties of these minerals that we've been talking about. All right, so the most diagnostic physical properties that we use are listed there at the top. So we've got color, luster, streak, crystal form, cleavage, fracture, hardness, and specific gravity. Okay, then some of these minerals are going to have very special diagnostic properties that will also help you. These include magnetism, fluorescence, smell, taste, feel, striations, double refraction, reaction to acid. Okay, so we'll go through these each individually. First one being color. Color is usually the first thing that somebody notices about a mineral, but unfortunately it is not a very good indicator of what mineral you're actually looking at, because a lot of minerals come in the same color variations. Okay, so we want to be very careful when we're using color. Sometimes color can help us, but not always, okay? So I'll tell you some of the key minerals that you want to look out for in terms of color and whether they come in various colors and colors that are similar to other minerals as well. So some of the most common minerals that are mixed up because of their color are beryl, quartz, and fluorite. We'll focus mostly on quartz and fluorite in this class, but know that they all come in very similar colors. So on the left here, we have fluorite, middle is beryl, and the far right is quartz. So you can see that some of the colors kind of overlap. They're all kind of a clear, translucent look to them. So it's going to be very difficult to tell them apart if you can't tell some of their other physical features apart from each other. All right, so the next one is luster. Luster is way more important than color because it tells us how light is reflecting off of mineral. Okay, so there's two big different lusters here. We have metallic and we have non-metallic. So if it's metallic, it looks like metal, period, full stop. Okay, so it looks like a metal. If it's shiny, that doesn't mean it's metallic. If it's not shiny, that doesn't mean it's not metallic. Okay, so you have to think of metals, what metals look like. They're not always shiny, and not all shiny things look like metal, right? So when you're thinking about this, think of a metal. Does it look like a metal? Okay, then if you don't think it looks like a metal and it looks non-metallic, we have a bunch of other terms that we can refer to. They include dull, earthy, pearly, resinous, silky, submetallic, which I won't really show you very much submetallic because those are really hard to distinguish between metallic and submetallic, and then non-metallic, vitreous or glassy, and then waxy. Okay, so a lot of them are going to be hard to tell the difference between, especially with things like pearly, resinous, and silky. They're very similar, especially with the samples that I will show you on video. So I generally only give you a couple to choose from, those being glassy, dull, waxy, and sometimes resinous. Resinous looks like dried glue, pearly looks like a pearl, silky looks like silk, but when you start looking at minerals, those start to look very similar until you get really good examples of them. And unfortunately, we don't have fantastic examples of all of these lusters. Dull will look pretty earthy and won't reflect much light. And same thing with earthy. Earthy will look like dirt or dried mud. And then glassy, of course, is probably the most common luster. And it looks like glass, right? So like that quartz there, or like the color, the beryl, the quartz, and fluorite that I just showed you. And then waxy looks like wax. So if you think about a candle, the way that a candle will reflect light, that's what a waxy mineral would look like. So in lab, I will show you a bunch of these crystals and have you try to identify which luster you think they are. All right, moving on to crystal form. So crystal form is the way that a mineral is growing in nature. Okay, so this is before it has been broken from any process or has grown in a rock. So this would grow in something like a geode, some open cavity, and it's the shape that it takes in that growth form. Okay, so some common crystal forms that we see are cube, octahedron, rhomb, dodecahedron, pyritohedron, and prisms. Okay, so here's a couple of examples here and some more here. So these show you the various kind of specialized crystal forms, but we generally describe them as some sort of geometric shape, and it helps us know which crystal we're looking at. Now, once these crystals are broken, they no longer exhibit their crystal form. Okay, so the crystal form is when they grow, and as soon as they break, they no longer exhibit their original crystal form. Okay, so we'll talk about what the breaking looks like in a second, but first we're going to talk about the robustness of a mineral, which is also known as the hardness. So we also want to know something about how robust a mineral is against other substances. Okay, so why is hardness important? Well, it tells us what we can use the mineral for. So if the mineral is really hard on this hardness scale, then we can't use it for things that we want for soft purposes. So for example, baby powder is made up of talc. It's not really made up of talc anymore, but it was called talcum powder before it was called baby powder, right? So it's primarily made up of talc, and talc is a 1 on this hardness scale. And so we can use talc for something like skin as it's ground up. But if we try to use quartz or topaz, it's such a hard mineral that even in powder form is going to be very coarse on your skin. It's not going to feel very good. In addition, we don't want to make glass out of gypsum because gypsum is pretty fragile. So we make glass out of things like quartz. Okay, so this is what we call the Mohs hardness scale. It was coined by a German geologist named Friedrich Mohs in the 20th century. And we use this to give us an idea of just how hard particular minerals are. Okay, so in my videos and in lab, we would use some common objects. So we'll use the nail, the penny, and your fingernail to try to distinguish where on the hardness scale the mineral you're looking at would lie. So your fingernail is about a 2.5, a copper penny is 3.5, and then the nail is a 6.5. You can also use a knife or a glass plate at the 5.5 range, and then a masonry drill bit, if you happen to have access to that, at an 8.5 there. And so we can kind of get a rough idea of where the mineral you're looking at has fallen on this hardness scale. All right, so when a mineral starts to break, it's going to break in one of two ways. It's either going to exhibit what we call cleavage, or it's going to fracture. Okay, so this first one we're looking at here is cleavage. And cleavage is when a mineral will break along planes of weakness. Okay, so here we have weak bonds in one direction and strong bonds in another. And along those weak bonds is where those cleavage planes will lie. And each mineral is going to exhibit either cleavage or fracture. If it has cleavage, it's going to exhibit 1 to 3, maybe 4 angles which it's meeting, okay? So there's gonna be different planes. So here we just see the one thin piece being pulled off, and that one piece is what we call one cleavage plane. Okay, but not all minerals have just one. Some of them have 2, 3, 4. Okay, so here are a couple of different minerals that you'll look at in lab, and we're gonna look at here. And so we have the one that we just looked at, A, is muscovite. So it's one direction, it's just that peeling sheet coming off. Then we have B, which is a feldspar, and what we're looking for are sets of parallel sides that are relatively flat. So we're looking for things that don't have a lot of bumps in them and they're parallel to each other. Now, if you look at a cleavage plane and it looks like it's slanted a little bit in opposite directions, and they would at some point meet each other, then those are not cleavage planes. Okay, so cleavage planes never meet each other. So here on the feldspar, you can see that there is a cleavage plane on the top, which means there would also be one on the bottom. So there are sets of parallel sides that you're looking for. Okay, so we have one on the top and the bottom, and then we have one on those sides where it's labeled number 2. We're looking at image B, number 2. And so then on the other side, there would also be another plane. Okay, hornblende looks very similar, where we have a 1 and a 2, so we have 2 cleavage planes there, but the difference there is that the angle of intersection between the 2 cleavage planes is not 90 degrees. You can see how it's kind of slanted. And so if we use, let's say we use this box, okay? So I'm using this scotch tape box. So let's say this is a mineral. So when you're looking for cleavage planes, you are looking for sets of parallel sides that are generally flat. Okay, so on here, you would take your fingers and try to match them. So I would say this is one cleavage plane. I would say that this is another cleavage plane. Right? And then this one right here is my last cleavage plane. So on this box, it has six sides. Okay? And each side has a parallel other side, and that makes up one cleavage plane. Okay? So this would have three cleavage planes, and they all meet at 90 degree angles, right? Those are 90 degree angles on the box. It's not slanted. If the box was slanted in some manner, I can't actually slant it without opening it. If it was slanted in one manner, like you see on the mineral hornblende C there, it would be a not meeting at 90 degree angle cleavage planes. Okay. Then we have D down there, which is halite. Those are similar to our box here, where there are three cleavage planes on that sample, and they all meet at 90 degrees. You move over to E, you see calcite. Calcite also has three cleavage planes, but it doesn't meet at 90 degrees. So you can see that there is an angle that is not 90, right? So we either say it's 90 or not 90. I won't ask you to actually measure the cleavage planes, although they are giving you the angle there, the angle of intersection. I won't ask you to actually measure that. It'll just be, is it 90 or not 90? Okay, and then the last one there, F, is fluorite. So that one actually has four cleavage planes. It's basically two pyramids stuck together. So if you think of the pyramids individual, you can get your fingers around that sample, and you'll see me do that in lab for you. Okay, so if the minerals are not exhibiting cleavage, they are going to fracture. And so if they fracture, this is just random breaking. There's no rhyme or reason to the breaking, and there's two different types here. We have irregular and we have conchoidal. With conchoidal fracture, we see kind of these hairline fractures within the surface, and they are usually in concentric circles. So this is going to be seen in something that's very, very glassy, so large-scale quartz, or it's also seen in obsidian, but obsidian is a rock, so we're not going to focus on that right now. But a lot of what you're going to see is irregular fracture, and then in quartz, you'll see the conchoidal fracture. All right, moving on to streak. Streak is the mineral in powder form, is what's leaving material on his hands, right? It's the residue left behind. And so the way that we test this in lab is we take the mineral and we strike it across a porcelain plate, and it shows some sort of color to us. And so a lot of these are going to be focusing on the metallic minerals, because the metallic minerals leave behind a lot more powder than some of the clear or glassy minerals do. All right, and then we have specific gravity. So this is basically the density of a mineral. Remember, density is mass over volume, so you need to weigh the specimen, and then you look at the displacement of water level, which is the volume that it would take up. So there you can get an actual density level from grams per cc, or grams per centimeters cubed. And this would tell you basically how heavy the mineral is. So if it's heavier, it's probably got a lot of metallic elements in it. So we are looking at some metallic minerals. Then in a couple of minerals, you might see magnetism. And so this is when there are iron oxide minerals attracted to magnets. So this happens in magnetite, lodestone, and ilmenite. We will look at magnetite in lab. It's very common. If you've seen some of those little round beads that are pictured here, like people make bracelets and stuff out of them. They are very common at like the fair and stuff. People like to throw them around and mess with them, but they are all made of magnetite. All right, then we have fluorescence, which is when minerals will glow under UV light. So there is a really cool display of this at the fair every October in Fresno. If you ever get a chance to go, I recommend it. They do show you a lot of various different minerals. A lot of mineral shows will also do that. If you go to some mineral show somewhere, I think there's one in Hanford and Turlock throughout the year. And so this is just, they contain elements that will react to that UV light. And so that reaction is exhibited in fluorescence. We don't have any that I will necessarily show you. So here's some lovely pictures and videos of them. All right, then we have smell, taste, and feel. Some minerals will either smell funny or taste funny or feel different. Some of them might be powdery. So, for example, the mineral kaolinite will be very powdery on your hands, and it'll be easy to identify if that's what you're looking at. Sulfur smells really bad. We have sulfur, but we don't really use it as identifying because it's not a rock-forming mineral. But we have it, for example, if you want to look at it. And then halite tastes like salt because it's made up of NaCl. It's made up of table salt, essentially. And so if you lick it, it will taste salty. All right, then we get into striations. So in our feldspars, there is one feldspar that has striations and one that doesn't. Striations are hairline fractures or grooves within the internal structure of the mineral. So when you run your fingernail across it, you don't necessarily feel all those grooves, but you can see them. So these three pictures in the middle all exhibit striations, and then one at the top with the little X over it does not. So the one at the top, they're not nice parallel hairline grooves. They're more kind of a wavy line running throughout. Okay, so the three in the middle are what we call plagioclase feldspar, and they all exhibit the striations. The potassium feldspar, which is the one at the top, does not show striations. The lines in there are not parallel. Okay, so this will help you distinguish between plagioclase feldspar and potassium feldspar. All right, then we have double refraction. So some minerals will polarize light and split into two. So the diagram on the left shows you light coming in, and then the mineral is that solid line that's horizontal. And then as it hits the mineral, the light will split into two different rays. And so that's what creates kind of a double effect. So it's like you're seeing double. So there in the middle is a piece of calcite, and it's going over words, and you can see there's basically like two words stacked on top of each other, and that is the double refraction through that mineral. And so that is very particular to calcite and a few other minerals, but calcite's the one that we look at the most. All right, and then we have reaction to acid. So some minerals, when you apply hydrochloric acid, will react because they are very basic. So an example here is, again, calcite. Calcite is made up of calcium carbonate, and calcium carbonate is a base. So if you put hydrochloric acid on that base, it will react and it'll bubble like this. All right, and then with all of those minerals moving forward, we're going to start looking at how they form rocks. And so this is just an intro to moving into igneous rocks here, but we have something called the Bowen's reaction series, which shows us when minerals are going to crystallize out of a magma. So if the crystals are actually crystallizing from a magma. So this Bowen's reaction series shows us at the highest temperatures, we are going to see olivine crystallize first, and at the lowest temperatures, we're going to see quartz. So quartz is going to crystallize last out of a magma, and it's going to give us really big crystals because it took so long to finish crystallizing. Whereas olivine crystallizes so quickly, it ends up being very small in nature. And so you'll work with this a couple of times throughout a couple of different weeks. And we'll also talk about the different igneous rock types, looking at olivine being very ultramafic, and then quartz creating a lot of our granitic material. And then we have a lot of different minerals in between. So this is the Bowen's reaction series. You'll have to fill this out at some point, probably on an exam and in the lab, and then we will work with it with igneous rocks as well. All right, so minerals are the building blocks of rocks. We are going to talk about the rock-forming minerals in these labs, and the physical properties are going to help you distinguish between minerals and then their potential use, okay? So next you're going to work on your lab and your homework assignment for the week, and I will see you guys in the next video. Bye!